Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Twa Teams. I forgot what it's called. Twa Teams on Street. That's always a good start when you forget. Who am I again?
We're only at number 235.
Wow. I'm getting on a bit. Anyway, welcome to this week's edition of Twa Teams on Street. I'm Tom Duthie, and podcasting alongside me and keeping me right is George Cran.
Hello.
Alan Temple.
Well done.
And Graeme Finnan.
Hello, everyone.
Right. Is that it? Is that what we'll have to do? Can I go home now?
It's all you have to.
No, because we're speaking about a Dundee win, George.
Yeah. Good win.
No, that's United. That's awesome. Even I know that. No, an excellent win. Did you see it coming?
I don't know, because Hearts have such good players in their team. I thought it was a good time to play them, though, in terms of in between big European games. Me and Alan were talking about that before. It was maybe the right time to get them, and you could kind of tell because they changed their team.
That's the point. We always go on about, you know, it's difficult for teams playing on a Sunday after they've played in Europe on a Thursday. Is it even more difficult when they're in the middle of a tie? Is that a distraction?
Yeah, definitely. And I think maybe because they lost at home and they're kind of thinking, oh, we've got to try and turn this around away, and that's maybe in the mind. Mm-hmm. I think it was probably in the mind of whoever picks the team at Hearts. Stephen Naismith, I guess.
The most suspiciously animated technical director in football.
Yes.
Yeah. You'll be surprised to find I've forgotten who the pretend manager is. What's his name again?
Well, let's not see him. The allegedly pretend manager is Frankie McAvoy.
Frankie McAvoy, yeah. That's him. I can picture him. But
Stephen Naismith was fronting up after the game because his team got beat. And Dundee deserved it. They were really good in the first half. Maybe could have created a bit more, but they did a lot more in the game with less of the ball than Hearts did with loads of the ball. I had a bit of a struggle second half.
I noticed that from the start, especially before Dundee went ahead. It was a phenomenal number of shots from Dundee and very few from Hearts.
Yeah, and it was strange. Somebody had mentioned in the first half as the game was going that Hearts had 65% possession. I was like, really? Because they've just passed it about. And Dundee looked far the more potent team. They hadn't created a huge amount in terms of actual chances on goal, but they were going forward and Hearts certainly weren't. Dundee had it tough when Hearts obviously changed things at halftime and took control of the game. But then Dundee scored against their own play with that brilliant goal from Luke McCown.
They did indeed.
I called the wonder goal, and the other podcast in our stable disputed it being a wonder goal, but
I'll bring Bear in here because he's a goalkeeper. You know, when I saw it, you know what I really liked about it? It came from a mistake, but Xander Clark, like Luke Cowan, spotted what was on right away. He made really, really good ground and made a great effort to cover up for his defender.
Xander Clark, 6'4".
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he's a big lad and he was at full stretch. So that was a brilliant chip from Luke McCown.
That was a wonder strike.
Just went under the crossbar. He had to get it off early because if he didn't, the keeper was back through.
Yeah.
It was great. It was a fantastic goal. Yeah, I'm not having it was a poor goal. It was a great goal.
The view from the press box, it was right in the top corner.
Yeah.
Perfectly in the top corner.
The only place he was going to score.
Our colleague Eric is very, very high standards for a man that covers a team that haven't scored a league goal yet.
Yes.
It's quite remarkable.
I think he's just worried about Saturday.
Yeah, quite possibly. He says with a seamless link.
We're coming for the farmers. But on the subject of the goal, we can all take great credit because we've said Luke McCown should be one of the men. And he's shown it on a sort of game basis, but over a season, the lad's got a great opportunity to go on and start as one of the big players.
And time again, he scored goals at this level before, but he has to increase his consistency level. And so far this season, he's been magnificent. Uh-huh. I mean, I think he's been man of the match in three of the four
games. Probably been the top player, I think. Yeah.
Absolutely, and he's got that ability as well. You saw that on Sunday to come up with a big goal. Great performance from him. And they've got to say, playing in an unusual role for him, the way the teams lined up at the start. You know, obviously Tiffany was outside of him in the mm-hmm. four, and he slotted into it well. I think the thing that we're talking about the goal here, and I'm going to turn it a wee bit. I saw real encouragement in the defence and in the fact to manage to grind out a clean sheet, because that, I think, in the long run, will keep Dundee. In this league, Dundee.
No, listen, I hear the sound of Bears back four drum beating coming. In the distance.
Yes, it is coming. And, you know, Hearts had, as George said, 65% possession, but Dundee did a lot more, but they're 35%. Yeah. There's no doubt about that. But Hearts, as every team does, Tom, in a game, they had their moment, and it was the 20 minutes at the start of the second half when they came out, you know, all guns blazing. And, they obviously had the free kick, which, I mean, Trevor Carson never had much to do, but he's been brought in to earn points for Dundee. And that's fingertip save. That earned them points mm-hmm. on Sunday. There's mm-hmm. absolutely no doubt about that. But the defence in general did well. Interestingly, the manager dropped Lee Ashcroft and brought in Jordan McGee. And that could be an ominous sign for Lee Ashcroft with Ricky Lamy warming up on the sidelines. But what gave me the most hope was Dundee's setup. They looked solid. They looked well drilled. I think the 2 weeks off, they've been working hard in training on certain things. And it was where, from my seat in the Bobby Cox stand, got a good view of the 4-4-2, and it was sometimes became a 4-5-1 because one of the strikers would drop back in. But they were well drilled, George. They left Hearts very little space. Hearts had, that's the reason Hearts had so much possession. Dundee were leaving them on the ball in their own half. And I think the Hearts fans thought, well, this is all right. You know, we've got plenty of possession here. But unfortunately, Hearts could not move the ball quickly enough mm-hmm. when they went into over the halfway line to drag Dundee about and create a bit of space. And as such, they never created a thing. So, yeah, it looked really, really solid. You know, it is ominous for Ashcroft, but he's a big man. He'll understand the situation. He'll be working hard to get back in the team. And But it could be difficult for him because they're looking really, really defensive. Rigidity at the back. I thought that going forward, there's still not quite. I thought Bakayoko had his best game without mm-hmm. actually looking like scoring.
That's the concern. I can't remember a chance he's really missed yet, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Like it's not been in there, maybe.
No, that's right. And Robinson gets a big chance in the second half and should really score. But it was a great all-round performance. I'm just looking at the setup. Obviously, I've been an advocate to change to the four at the back, and he did that. But I still think, with Lamy coming in, he now has the personnel to go back to three if he so wishes. But it looks
we've been putting up with this for weeks, and now you just change your mind.
I can see where he's thinking. No, he won't go. No, I don't see it changing at the weekend. I don't see that happening anytime soon. But I think the way he's doing it, Tom, sometimes teams that are built around players, a certain player on the team, and the manager will try and build the team around that player to get that player on the ball. Dundee are going to be built on a system, and players are going to have to adapt to that system. You're going to get things like Luke McEwen playing just inside mm-hmm. the left, when Luke McEwen normally plays on the left, and you're going to get things like mm-hmm. Leo Cameron coming on late in the game and going over onto the left. Leo Cameron wants to be in the middle, but he's going over onto the left because they've all been drilled to do a job and do a job properly. So it doesn't matter who you take out or who you put on, they can all go into various positions and do that job because the manager has them well versed on what they have to do. And it worked brilliantly on Sunday. I was delighted for the team. I was delighted for the manager because he needed to get a first win as a manager under his belt. And it's positive signs for Dundee, Tom.
Mm-hmm. Alan Beer picked up that point there that Tony Docherty seems to be working on systems rather than building around individuals. When that happens, players are always put out a wee bit because they end up out of position. But the flip side of that is, he obviously has confidence in them because he's Luke McEwen. He's saying to Luke McEwen, you can play one inside. He's saying to Lyle Cameron when he sends him on, you can do a job on the left. And players can take something from that, can't they?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think anyone that's on the books of Dundee would accept that they're maybe not the sort of extraordinary elite talent that you would build a system around. And mm-hmm. that's just a fact of life. A manager will have a shape that he thinks suits the squad that he's got, but and ultimately, he's only going to change that if you've got particularly special players that are worth changing and building an entire team around. And frankly, I don't think that's the right way for a team like Dundee to operate. I think you want system to be stronger than your individuals as a whole, and hopefully people can excel within that system. But I think it speaks really well to the versatility of the guys you've mentioned, that they are able to do those different roles. And I mean, we mentioned earlier, you know, Jordan McGee coming into the side, he's perhaps stands out more than anyone as exemplifying that versatility. And you will
really is the modern professional, isn't he? You can play 3 or 4,
and you're going to need that, because you can't run a squad. Well, although the speed that Tony Docherty signs players, maybe they can run a squad of 30, but generally it's not wise to run a squad of, you know, a great deal more than 25. You probably want less than that, to be honest, to keep everybody happy. Mm. And within that, when you get injuries, suspensions, players maybe wanting to move on or whatever, you need guys that can play more than one position. I mean, not to take it across the street, but obviously, you know, it's something that I spoke to Jim Goodwin about earlier this week when he was talking about having signed Kevin Holt and Liam Grimshaw specifically because they can play 3 different positions. Yeah. And the fact that Dundee have got guys that are showcasing the fact that they can perform admirably in 2-3 different positions, 2 different formations, is a real positive. Real positive, because it will ultimately, you know, help Dundee have that versatility as the season goes on, and hopefully a bit of fluidity.
And George Bear made a big play there of the defensive solidity on Sunday, but is there another difference from this season to 2 seasons ago when they were last in the Premier League? Is it in players like Cameron, Tiffany, McCowan, Mulligan even? They've got guys that can hurt other teams and create things.
They do.
And some of them were there 2 years ago, but they're 2 years more experienced and older.
McCowan in particular, it's kind of talked about that, and he's looked at his first season at Dundee in the Premiership, and he's taken a lot of lessons from that, how he was probably Dundee's brightest player from the first half of the season. I think he was top scorer for a wee bit. And then things obviously tailed off for the entire team. But he spoke before the season, and he spoke after the game on Sunday as well, that he's using that himself. He feels like he's one of the more mature players in the squad. He's only 25, but that's true, because it's such a young squad. But he's also said that he's been telling the younger players that it's not about yourself, and it's not about how you're looking individually, but it's how the team's doing is more important. So that's obviously something he learned from that first season, and he's trying to impart that on the young squad. But the goals is the one thing that they need to add. I think I agree with Bear. I think they're looking pretty sturdy in terms of defence. I mean, talk about Trevor Carson, that it was a great save, but I don't remember him making any other saves, which tells you the defence in front of him was working really, really well to protect him, protect the goal, and get that clean sheet. Still, I've said this a few times on the podcast already, there's still only one game under Tony Docherty where they've scored more than one goal against Dumbarton. So that's something they need to add to. Looking at that Zach Robinson chance.
I was feeling quite cheery with that game, man.
No, but that's a good thing. And they've got the defence in place that sometimes you only need one goal. But I think they would have made life a wee bit easier for themselves had they added a second. And that's just the next challenge they've got to take on. Because I think they're looking pretty solid at the moment. And I do fancy them on Saturday going to McDermott, which has not been a happy hunting ground for them, but I do fancy
them. Well, they're going into that one bare 4 points. You would take that, and if they could make it 7 points, going into this international break, it's a great start.
Oh, fantastic start, but, you know, St Johnstone will have other ideas. You've got an opposition in front of you. But it's a great start for Dundee, and you look at the games they've played. The two teams who they've dropped points to, they drew with Motherwell, they lost at St Mirren, and they were a wee bit unfortunate, I told you this, man, are both at the top end of the team. I mean, it is a good start.
Second and third.
Yep, but it is only a start. And we're talking about Dundee having a big squad. They have a big squad, but Tony Docherty, already I can see he's a fair manager. If you do well, you will go in the team. You will stay in the team. We saw Cammy Kerr doing well the last 15 minutes at St Mirren, suddenly he's back in the team. A lot of people thought we'd never see Cammy Kerr again. Yeah. I never sort of thought that, because I know what Cammy Kerr's like, and I know how valuable a player he can be over the course of a season. But he came in and he did well against Hearts. The guys at Lowry gave him a bit of a roasting at the start of the second half. But as always with Cammy Kerr,
he grinds away,
and ultimately comes out on top in that battle. Similarly, Finn Robertson, who came in from the cold. I saw Finn play in the, it wasn't under 21 game, it was a cup, the
Challenge Cup.
Challenge Cup, that was at Dens against East Fife. Stood out like a sore thumb, as you would expect. The player has ability with a lot of young lads around him, but still stood out, did a good job. He's in the team on Sunday. He looks as though he can do a turn as well for Dundee. So, yeah, I mean, it is a good start, but I've been to Perth before when we've gone up there expecting to get a result and we've been turned over. So Tony Docherty won't let the players get too far ahead of themselves. It's one result. They have to go and put a strong performance in again, but they have ticked a few boxes. I said right at the start of the season, there's a lot of boxes to tick in the Premier League before you can say we're here now. The first one was get a point on the board, get a goal at home, you know, get a win under your belt, get a clean sheet. They've done that now. Can they do it on the road? Can they go and score, as George says, score more than one goal, tick that box, get points on the road? Can they do that? Once you've ticked all these boxes, then you can start to say, well, and look at where you are compared to other teams, you can start to say with confidence, I think we're going to be all right this season.
I agree with George. I fancy Dundee going to Perth. I really do. Second mention of them in this podcast, but reading obviously a lot of Eric's coverage of St Johnstone.
That'll be Nicholson.
Eric
of
Nicholson,
Perth,
of course. his coverage of St Johnstone's fine 0-0 draw at Celtic Park, and you know, really interesting, really laudable result, clearly. But I still think there's huge questions over whether that team is able to dictate a game, create chances, score goals, and with the way they've started the league. There's going to be a lot of pressure on St Johnstone to go out there and actually make the running in a game. And I always think
as well, managers like to say our season won't be judged on our results against the Old Firm. What they need to, and I'm sure Stephen McLean does, that goes for good results against them as well, because many times do we see a team get a good result against the Old Firm and fall on their face the next week. And also, as great as it was for St Johnstone last Saturday getting a 0-0 and a well-deserved 0-0 at Parkhead, it's a totally different game when you're playing someone that's comparable to you on your own patch, because you're going to have to do a bit more attacking.
Absolutely, and I think Tony Docherty will fancy the way this game needs to shape up from a St Johnstone perspective, which is their fans will say, okay, Celtic Park was good, now our season starts, let's see what you've got, and they'll be expected to come out and make the running and create chances. I think Tony Docherty would be very happy to use the pace that he's got on his side on the break and look to create chances that way. I don't think Dundee will go there and try and dictate the game, but in terms of a nice little counter-attacking strategy, I could see the game panning out quite well for Dundee, but as Bear says, I mean, it's football. You never can say that.
It could be interesting because... No, St Johnstone could be a counter-attacking strategy. Does anyone go over the halfway line?
I both sitting in their own half going, you attack?
Yeah.
But I mean, the selfish point of view, I want everyone that Dundee's about to play to have lost their last 10 games and make it 11 in a row. But it's good because, I mean, even a week ago we were speaking here going, God, this could be a relegation derby already. But both teams, both sets of fans have had a lift. Add to the atmosphere. And something both sets of players have to cope with adds to the expectation as well, doesn't it?
Definitely. Well, Dundee is certainly expecting. I hope there'll be a big crowd making the short trip down to Perth for what they won't call a derby, but it's, I guess, a local rival.
Leave early. Yes, they've still not fixed the bridge at Glencars.
But as I said before, I fancy Dundee to just keep rolling on. I get that feeling about the way they've shaped up under Tony Docherty. You could see the first few games, they're not giving much away at all, which is really good for a newly promoted team. Look back at, you mentioned the season a couple of years ago. At this point, I think they conceded 10 goals by now, which is that included a thumping at Celtic Park, which maybe, as you say, you don't count.
Distorted it slightly.
Yeah. But they were
still got that to come, George.
Yes.
They were far easier to play against a couple of years ago. They just looking like every week they're looking like a really tough team to get past.
Even Mo Salah came on late in the game last week, but impacted
who?
The game.
He wasn't here last week.
I know.
Along with Jamie Lamy, Ryan Howley,
Ricky Lamy. Who's Jamie Lamy?
Jamie Lamy's his brother. Jamie drove him up. He's still here.
They'll sign Jamie Lamy at some point. If he's a midfielder, they'll sign him. That's what you can guarantee.
If Tony Docherty's listening, who's this Jamie Lamy? Why do I love him?
It was interesting though. I was speaking to the manager yesterday's pre-match stuff, and particularly for Silla and Ryan Howley, he'd identified that Samurran game in the first half that he needed to add more power, more physicality in the middle of the park, and that's what those two have been brought in. And you could see that when Silla came on, he looked very strong. And
well, the first thing he did was brush aside a Hearts player, and the next thing he did was going to crunch and tackle a Hearts player. So that'll do for me.
I think that's very much his game.
I liked him coming on because I immediately thought, here's a guy the manager's done his homework on. He's an experienced player. He's a physical player. The manager's no worried about him not knowing systems right away. He knows these last 15, 20 minutes, his job is to keep them out.
Yeah. I think on this podcast, I think we discussed earlier in the season about the fact that when Dundee were last relegated, they were quite a small team. And that showed up in a lot of fixtures in the Premiership. And fair play to Tony Docherty, he has ensured that that criticism cannot be levelled at Dundee this season. That is a team full of physicality and strength and energy, and if they're going to lose games, they're not going to lose games because they've been bullied, which I think is a real positive.
And George, just before we get on to the chances of more signings before the deadline, I mean, there's a whole day, that's like half a team for Tony Docherty. But he also wants fire and ice. What does that mean?
That's some sort of cocktail.
That's Game of Thrones. No, it's fire when you've not got the ball.
Winter's coming.
It's sadly. Fire when you've not got the ball. So intense pressing, trying to get it back and making sure you don't get bullied, as you say. And ice when you've got it. So
that's a really good... I get it now. I had no idea what that meant.
I quite liked it when he was speaking earlier in the week. And it's about... being intense when you've not got it, calming down when you've got it, composure to be able to keep the ball when you need to. So it's interesting that he was talking about having to be...
Could he not just say, get stuck in when we've not got the ball, sensible when you've got it?
That doesn't fit in a headline.
Yeah, it doesn't give George a pull quote. Come on, you've not been... I mean, you've been away too long.
Now. I'm a fan I just want it in really, really easy to understand words.
No, we need headlines. We still need headlines.
But it's interesting, though, because he's talking about having to be comfortable when you've not got the ball. And obviously, we saw that against Hearts, that worked at T. And that's what's going to happen at times this season as a newly promoted team. And it's a real positive if they can do that and be strong and be comfortable. Comfortable is a good word, to not be stressed about not having the ball and throwing themselves into tackles and stuff, but being composed in their shape, stopping the other team and quite happy in that.
I think they were that on Sunday. I mean, even though Hearts, obviously, they had that 20-minute spell after half-time, then Dundee scored, and I thought Dundee for the next 10, 15 minutes looked as though they would get another one, and then Hearts came back into it, as you would expect, as the time wore on. Ticking. Yeah, but even in that period, they still looked... They weren't lashing balls everywhere.
There was just that one scramble.
Yeah, there was their bodies on the line. But other than that, you know, they do seem quite calm and assured in what they've got to do.
And George, what five players is he signing before tomorrow night's deadline?
He said on Wednesday that he's quite happy with the squad.
But he's working on a few things.
He also said never say never.
Brilliant.
So,
the one thing that occurs to me is about, I mean, you mentioned it, Alan. You get in excess of 20, 25 players in a squad, they're going to be a lot of unhappy boys. And I think at the back, where he had to strengthen, once everyone's fit, if that happens, he's going to have a lot of centre halves and stuff like that. A few. I always err on it, just from experience. I mean, there's a couple of Mexican lads here. Portales is injured. Pineda's no getting a sniff just now. Mm-hmm. Very often when you're a long way from home, it doesn't take as long for you to go, well, it's time for me to go. I mean, how does he keep everybody happy?
Well, the one thing I have noticed is he's not making that many subs either. Maybe one or two a game. So even the boys who aren't getting in the starting team.
Unlike
or sitting watching.
Unlike Gary Boyer.
Well, that's the thing. Yeah, you got
everybody,
too many.
Everybody was on.
Yeah, the manager, physiotherapist went on the
park. Yeah. Everybody went on the park. Yeah.
So it's interesting whether that will change.
You know, they'll be doing things in training. Hopefully that'll ensure. It's still early in the season, but you're right. I mean, and we're talking about Dundee bringing players in. I wouldn't be surprised. Obviously, Max Anderson's gone up to Inverness.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised seeing a couple more maybe going out on loan. Yeah. I mean, where did Dundee? What would you say, George? Where did Dundee need players?
I mean, I think he'd maybe like to add another striker. I'm not sure. We've not seen Zach Rodden get much of a sniff. I think he came on at Simone, I think. But
Keener more likely to be one of the ones loaned.
I think so. It feels that way. I think he would only let him go if he'd had somebody coming in. As you mentioned, Ashcroft has drifted down the pecking order a bit with Lamy coming in, and McGee, who I thought that was, I've not been a huge fan of him in the top flight as a centre back, but I thought he was excellent against Hearts.
He's got what I'm saying about Ashcroft is a bit pigeonholed. Yeah. He's got to play in the back.
Exactly.
He's got to play back.
It feels like Shaughnessy. He's similar to Shaughnessy in terms of that kind of.
McGee is, we spoke about his versatility, so he could go into midfield. He could play at centre back. He could go to either side. He could go to right back or left back. You know, his versatility will get him games this season.
And you've got Patalis to come back.
I certainly wouldn't see Ashcroft going anywhere.
No, but I just. Yeah, how much game time you might get, because you've got Donnelly to come back as well, which we've not seen yet. Tyler French played 90 minutes for the reserves in the week. So obviously he can play right back as well. Interesting to see how much game time he gets. Obviously he was signed by the previous manager, Gary Bowyer. That's always an interesting one when a new manager comes in.
Does sound like they've got an awful lot of centre-backs when you list them.
So we'll stick Kamikera in there, why not? You can play centre back.
I mean, that sounds like
that's because Tony Docherty knows they got six the last time they were at Celtic.
But then if he wants to play three, he does need probably five at least, don't you, just for backup?
I said this before, managers won't be upset about having too many players. No, players might get upset about that, but managers won't be upset about it. And we said this, you know, the last time they were up, there's a few players still there from 2 years ago in the Premier League, and overall that team was not good enough to stay in. You have to bring players in there. And we're seeing that now. You know, Trevor Carson experienced at this level, Joe Shaughnessy experienced it, Ricky Lamy's come in, a lot of game time under his belt.
Not to mention Jamie.
Yeah. Jamie Siller.
And before we round up, well done. A sign of a team that's doing well, Mulligan. And the other one, I'm forgetting everybody's names today.
Lyle Cameron.
Just round Lyle Cameron.
I know, I couldn't find
it. Joyce Mulligan must be about 26. These
age group things are always a minefield, because it's players born on or before for this competition, and they end up, if you get to the finals, guys are 22, 23 and stuff like that playing. But it shows that they're heading in the right direction.
Exactly. Interesting that I'd spotted Scott Gemmell at the game on Sunday. Josh Mulligan didn't play, and Lyle Cameron was a late sub, I think. Did he come on? Can't even
came
remember.
Came on late on the left wing, yeah.
So he never really got to see the players that he was coming to see. But no, it's definitely a good sign. I mean, Mulligan's been in that squad pretty regular for a while, and I get the feeling that Lyle Cameron will be alongside him for a while as well.
I think Gemmell likes Mulligan. Yeah. I was at one of his appearances when he played Northern Ireland at St Mirren, whatever their stadium's called, the Smitha, or whatever it is. Mulligan was really good. He was actually playing sort of attacking midfield, bombing into the box.
He played quite far up the park.
I think Gemmell likes the physicality and energy he brings to the midfield, definitely, which is particularly valuable at that youth group where maybe not everybody does have that.
They're a way to play Spain.
Exactly.
Guys that can run.
Exactly. So I think of all the, and we've got four call up from sort of our patch for the 21s, I think Mulligan's maybe
say
the...
that for part two.
It's not really that interesting, is it? Mika's and Newman's in there as well, so that's that covered. And I think...
I made sure I remembered their names.
I think Mulligan's, I think, maybe the one that's the most impressed.
Yeah, he's been just a regular pick for a while now. You can tell that. But I get the feeling that Cameron's certainly got the ability to be a regular pick as well. And
might get to play in the middle.
We'll see.
So you can remember where he plays. I just keep forgetting his name.